present properly.
Just 1 minute. I mean, I think I have the screen up there. It's a pretty...
Yes, sir. Now it is on.
It's on now? Okay. Excellent. But I still will have to put it in the slideshow mode, right? Just a minute. I'll put it in the slideshow mode. Right, it's coming up, yeah. As I told you, every platform is different, you know. I'm more used to Cisco, WebEx, Zoom, Microsoft Teams, you know, a whole lot of other links are there. Okay, excellent. So can you all see this picture?
Yes, sir. That's all.
Can you see this huge elephant?
Yes, sir.
Elephant, it's not a captive elephant, it's a wild elephant. This is in the state. This can happen only in one state. And these are the elephants of Bengal. The Bengali elephant is especially special. And you see this elephant that has stopped a bus on the road near Siliguri, and it is systematically ransacking the bus and trying to see what food is there inside. You know, all the passengers have got down and they're standing at a safe distance and they're watching. Okay, so this is what I said in the beginning. Elephants can feed on almost anything. And they even get drunk. This is a marula tree in Africa. Elephant is shaking the tree to get the fruit. You know, feeds on it, gets fermented, and then elephant staggers around and lies down. However, at the same time, the 3D feeding proclivities of the elephant takes it into conflict with people. And this is something that you read about it almost every day in the newspapers. You know, in Tamil Nadu, near Coimbatore, you have a lot of conflict. In Karnataka, in the Kodagu district, you have conflicts. You have a whole lot of conflicts in central India. If you go to Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, South Bengal, you know, these are all elephants, a herd of elephants wandering around in southern Bengal and central India. You know, when the paddy is ripening, this is about the season, November, December, is when they go out in large herds, they're found in agricultural landscapes. They get out of the forest, you know, and even sometimes when you have large forest areas, the elephants are not content to stay inside the forest. They go out of the forest and they feed on the agricultural crops. And this brings it into direct conflict with people. So this is an issue that we have to address. And we can ask the fundamental question of why do elephants come into conflict with people? Why do they come and raid crops? Sometimes, very often, even when they have enough forage inside the forest to meet their normal needs. So as I told you, you know, much has been written about the enormous quantities of food that elephants need. You know, people will tell you, oh, but you know, elephants need a lot of space. You know, they have typically an adult male can feed on 300 kilos of fresh water, fresh weight in fodder every day. But however, you know, as a biologist, as an animal physiologist, if you look at it, the quantity is not large when it comes to body size. You know, smaller animals eat more in relation to their body size. A rat will consume much more, you know, per day in relation as a percentage of its body size compared to an elephant. An elephant typically consumes maybe about 8%, 10% of its body weight in terms of fresh fodder every day. But when it comes to a rat, it might, you know, get much more in terms of its body weight as fresh fodder. And this is related to the basal metabolic rate. So the metabolic rate of a shrew or a mouse is much greater than that of an elephant because of the surface area ratio and the total amount of energy that is lost by a smaller mammal compared to a larger mammal. So elephant consumes a large amount of food in absolute terms, but not in terms of its own body weight. It consumes a much smaller percentage of food, only about 2% in terms of dry weight of its body weight and about 8 to 10% in terms of the fresh weight in relation to the body weight every day. That's something we need to keep. And this is the kind of relationship that you find in terms of body mass. This is a log scale, and the daily food intake of an elephant is still lower than that of a rat. Many years ago, you know, 30 or 40 years ago, I began my research on elephants exactly 40 years ago. You know, it's a little over 40, you know, almost close to 40 years now. The fundamental question that I was asking is whether elephants are grazers or browsers. You know, you will find a lot of people writing about elephants and they only write about the grazing habits of elephants, that elephants feed on a lot of grass. Now you go to Africa, you go to a place like Amboseli, and this is a picture I've taken in Kenya and Africa. You come across a scene like this, very common. You know, it's a very large expanse of grassland, very little forest cover. And what do the elephants do? They feed on grass. So you can observe them for hours together, you know, 8 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours, and they feed on grass. They go on feeding on grass. You go to Sri Lanka, and this is a place called Minaria in central Sri Lanka. You see some forest in the background, but in the foreground, you get the lake bed, which is a reservoir there, and you have a lot of grass growing in the bed of the reservoir. And you look there, and elephants are feeding on grass. Typically in the evening, afternoon, you go there, the elephants come out and they feed on the grass. So you might be tempted to conclude that the elephant, Asian elephant at least, is mainly a grazer, you know? But then we know that elephants go into the forest. The elephants live in the forest. And, you know, a long time ago, many years ago, it was much easier for a biologist to go and observe elephants out in a grassland and an open area. They rarely bothered to follow an elephant inside the forest. You know, the visibility is low, the density of the forest is very high, the understory is very dense, and very often you don't see the elephant very easily. And it's also very, very risky. You know, you have to go very close to the elephant. The elephant might get annoyed, it might charge at you, and therefore many biologists don't go behind the elephant. And when they feed inside the forest, they feed in the woodland, they feed on bamboo, they feed on leaves, grass, you know, everything, you know, they feed on the bark of various trees, they feed on fruits. Then how do you quantify this? How do you kind of quantify the importance of browsing versus grazing in the diet of the elephant? This question is important not just from the point of view of animal physiology, of the ecology of the elephant, but it's also important in terms of conservation. You know, for instance, very often the forest department, somebody will say, no, you need to create a lot of grasslands for the elephant. So do we need to create grasslands? Do you need to cut the forest? Or do you need to preserve the forest and keep the forest also for the elephant? This is a very important question.
So I'm sorry to interrupt, but yes. There's a pop-up there about the Google Chrome sharing the video webcam and everything, which mm-hmm. is like interrupting the presentation screen. So maybe you can hide it. Like you just have to click on hide the option below.
Just 1 minute now.
Yes.
Oh, there is a pop-up here.
Yes, sir. You can just click hide there, and then even on top there's a green color tab which says Google Chrome is using the webcam. You can close both of that.
Yeah, just 1 second. I'm coming to the Google Chrome is using the webcam, right?
Yes, sir. You can just close that.
Yes, I'm presenting. Yeah, just once again, just let me know.
You can just drag it, sir, because it.
I can just say hide. Okay, got it. Yes. Yeah. It is sharing your screen. I don't have to say stop sharing. I say hide. Correct.
Yeah.
Right below.
Yeah, this one will go hide. Yes.
1 second. Yeah.
Yeah, and the above one, the green one, you can just put your cursor on it and drag it on right.
Or drag it to the right. Okay, got it.
Somewhere right, because it will go from the middle of your screen.
I know.
Yeah.
I wondered how to drag it, and sometimes it goes, and sometimes it doesn't go. So the titles are being hidden, is it?
Exactly. Yes. Yeah. The main heading of the slides. Yeah. I think now it will get better. I think.
It will get better, hopefully. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. Okay.
This is perfect. Thank you, sir.
This is perfect. Okay, excellent. Okay, let me go back to mine. And let me put it again in the slideshow mode, right?
Thank you for interrupting, sir. Thank you.
Okay, is it fine now?
Yes, sir, it's perfect.
Excellent. Okay, so this is almost, you know, 37, 38 years ago. I was thinking about how to solve this problem. You know, Professor Partha, I also have a background in botany, although I work on elephants. And I knew about the two major pathways of carbon fixation by plants. You know, you have the C3 plants and you have the C4 plants. The C3 plants are the majority of the shrubs and the trees and the, whatever you name it, the herbaceous plants and so on. And the seafood plants are the tropical grasses and some plants from the sedges, that is the cypressee. Now, you have different isotopes of carbon. You know, when you take carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, 12 carbon is the most common carbon. You also have 14 carbon. 14 carbon is a radioactive carbon, which decays with a half-life of 5,000 odd years. You also have 13 carbon. Now, 13 carbon is a very, very small quantity, and 14 carbon is even a smaller quantity or percentage. But a sum of the carbon dioxide that the plant fixes is 13 carbon and not 12 carbon. Okay. And there is a ratio of the 13 carbon to the 12 carbon in plants, which varies between the C3 plants and the C4 plants. And these are the numbers that I have given here. You don't need to get into great amount of detail. You can Google and you can read up on this if you wish to. But there is something called a delta 13C, which is a ratio of 13 carbon to 12 carbon. It's about minus 11 in the C3 plants per million. The C4 plants is more like minus 28, 29. So there is a difference, there is a differentiation between these two type of plants. Now C3 plants is browsing and C4 plants is grazing. Now let us think of an animal like a buffalo, you know, grazing in the Serengeti in Kenya. Now what would it feed on? It would feed entirely on C4 plants. Maybe a little bit on C3 plants, but entirely on C4 plants. So the organic carbon in its body, various biochemical fractions, you know, it could be protein, it could be lipids, it could be bone collagen. It will reflect the 13 carbon, 12 carbon ratio of the food source. So it will reflect this minus 29, you know, in some form or the other. On the other hand, you consider a giraffe. The giraffe, what does a giraffe do? It does not graze at all. It does not feed on C4 plants at all. It's only feeding on C3 plants. So the organic carbon in its system will reflect the minus 11 value. So a giraffe's, if you start measuring organic carbon in a giraffe, the 13 carbon, 12 carbon ratio, it will reflect the minus 11. And in a buffalo, it will reflect a grazing animal like a buffalo, it reflects minus 28. So what I did was I started collecting bone samples of elephants, dead elephants in the field, and I started measuring the 13 carbon, 12 carbon ratio of the protein called collagen. And what you actually find is that, you know, over a period of time, I did more than 50 such samples, and I came across one very interesting pattern. That interesting pattern was that there are elephant populations both in India as well as in other countries in Africa, where the elephant is a 100% browser. That is 100% of the diet, the protein, the organic, that you know, the amino acids that come from your food plants, 100% of it comes only from browse plants or C3 plants. You also have elephants that feed on grass to the extent of 50%. That is 50% of the organic carbon comes from C3, 50% of the organic carbon comes from C4 plants. And this is related to rainfall. So if you plot the rainfall, annual rainfall, and if you plot the delta 13C, you will find a relationship in very high rainfall areas. Like if you go to Assam or you go to West Bengal, you go to Central African forests, the diet comes almost entirely from browse. Then if you come to habitats in savannas, like in, you know, the Serengeti, you come to Masai Mara, you come to Amboseli, you come to Mudumalai, up to 50% of the diet can be grass and 50% can be browse. But the important thing to remember is that not a single population so far measured, their diet is purely grass or C4. And therefore, it's important to remember that elephants need a lot of browse in their diet. And this also means that elephants need forests. Elephants need to source at least maybe 50-60% of their organic carbon from browse plants or from C3 plants. And therefore, the preservation, conservation of browse-rich forests are important to elephants, not just the grassland. This is the conclusion I came to from both from primary work on Asian elephants, as well as by looking at similar studies done in Africa much later. In fact, the African studies came later than the Asian elephant studies that I did on, you know, almost 37, 38 years ago. So, but if you look at the evolutionary history of the elephant, I think it's important for us to understand the present day feeding habits of the elephant, which may not be the feeding habits 5 million years ago or 10 million years ago or whatever it is, you know, 2 million years ago. The elephant's feeding habits may have changed. The elephant's feeding habits would have changed according to the vegetation type in the past, which itself has changed depending on climate, on the climate. And climate has driven a change in the habitat of the elephants and other creatures over the past 50, 60 million years ago. And it has changed the diet of the elephant over this time period, you know, going back to the Paleocene to the present. I'm not going to give you a lecture today about the elephant proboscidian evolution itself, but just to show you how the diet of the ancestral elephant to the present has changed over time. Right. This is a paper that we published, the old carbon isotope paper was published by me, you know, somewhere in the mid-1980s and the early 1990s. Now, 30 years later, Professor Patnaik from Punjab University, you know, and I teamed up. And we have looked at how the diet of the elephant has changed over time. Now, I'm trying to give you all this background because I want to really understand, why is it that elephants are so fond of the ragi? Why the elephants are so fond of the paddy? You know, why are they not content with just feeding on the forest plants? Why do they come out into the fields near Coimbatore or in West Bengal or wherever else it is? And why do they are so fond of the crops that we cultivate? So let us understand the evolution of the feeding ecology of the elephant. Now look at this graph now. The graph goes back to looking at, you know, the evolutionary history of the elephant going back to 14 million years. The y-axis is a scale that is in millions of years. The x-axis is the delta 13 carbon. And from the delta 13 carbon, we are trying to infer the diet. So the diet is given on the top, the C3 browsers in green, on the left side of the figure. On the right side, you have the C4, which is the grazing, the grazers. And in between, you have a period where you have the mixed feeders. So look at the time period on the y-axis from 14 million years to about, let us say, 7 million years. What are you finding? You are finding that the elephants, the ancestral elephants, are entirely browsers. The dental apparatus of the elephant was very different. The dental apparatus could not cope with, a grazing diet at all. And therefore, those ancestral elephants, the Gomphotheridae, the Deinotherium, Stegelophodon, Stegodon, Anancus, all these elephants were, and these are, all these samples are collected from Asia. Okay. All these were essentially browsers. Then between 7 million years and about 3 million years, let's say approximately 4 million years, you have a situation when these elephants are now shifting their diet from being a browser to a grazer. Okay, so you see that trend. Okay, I don't know whether I can show the cursor and whether it's visible to you. So from a purely browsing diet, it is now changing to a grazing diet. And you see all these different species, Palaeodoxodon, Elephas hycetricus, all of this lived in the subcontinent about 2 million years ago. You will find that the diet is entirely grazing. It's a purely grazing diet. The dental apparatus changed. Elephants became large in body size. The number of lamellae in the molars increased. The crown length increased, and so on. Something called the hypsodonty index increased, and the elephants were able to now chew the fibrous grasses to a much greater extent, and that's what you see, right? Then you come to the more modern times now, you know, and suddenly once again you find that the browsers are appearing here, right? You have a mixed feeder, but you have a range here. You're going from grazing to browsing. You get an entire range in terms, very diverse type of a diet is what the modern elephants have got. Okay, so these are just the factual pattern that we see, and let me try and explain it at the end. I was always very puzzled by it. You know, the elephant dental apparatus is adapted for grazing, but still, why are they browsing to such a large extent? Because of, that is what is reflected in the carbon isotope ratios. Okay, now I change gears. I come to conflicts. Crop depredation is very widespread across Asia and Africa. Crores of rupees worth damage, and 500 people are killed each year by elephant due to conflicts. And when I began my research a long time ago, the number of people being killed by wild elephants each year was about 125 in the early 1980s. And today it has reached about 500. So the conflict has increased fourfold. Loss of property, huts get damaged, people get killed on the top right, and the maize crop and all other crops are damaged by the wild elephants. Elephants also come into cities. This is again a Bengali elephant in the town of Siliguri. It's a tuskless male elephant. He has come in and, you know, on a festival day, obviously, but I'm sure that he will do it not only on a Hindu festival, but also on a Christian or Islamic festival day. And he has come into the mall, local mall in the town of Siliguri. And he is kind of having a football with all the motorcycles and, you know, whatever else that is there. He probably came looking for food. You know, there's a local market. People are unloading sacks of potato or God knows what, and he probably wants a share of that. Now, the question that we can ask is, what are the causes of conflict? Sometimes the narrative that you get in the popular media, you know, the social media, the newspapers, sometimes even among scientists, biologists, you need to think deeply enough, and you need to understand what are the real causes of conflict, of elephant-human conflict. What is the popular narrative? The popular narrative is that elephants have lost habitat. The habitat is fragmented, the habitat is degraded, and therefore the elephants are coming out and raiding crops. Now, by implication, this also means that the elephants have no food inside the forest. Therefore, they're coming out of raiding crops. This is the popular narrative. And it is correct, of course, it's correct. But the story does not stop there, and that's what I will say. Now, I am trying to divide the causation into two categories. What I call proximate causation and what I call ultimate causation. As a biologist, proximate causation is the immediate cause for some biological phenomena. So you can ask the question, why are male elephants more aggressive? The answer from a physiologist would be proximate. Male elephants are more aggressive because they have higher levels of testosterone, male sex hormone, and that makes it more prone to aggression. But an evolutionary biologist will ask the question, and what is the ultimate causation? And the answer from an evolutionary biologist would be that there has been selection for higher levels of testosterone in male elephants, because male elephants that had a genetic mutation that produced more testosterone were able to dominate over other males in the population and thereby spread their genes, you know, more successfully to the next generation. Therefore, the ultimate causation is that, you know, that is an evolutionary explanation. So I'm dividing this into proximate and ultimate. The proximate is habitat loss, fragmentation, degradation. But you also have other land use changes, you have adverse climatic events, you have elephant population increase, which many people probably refuse to believe. But then I'm also looking at foraging theory, I'm looking at behavioral ecology, I'm looking at learning and culture. Okay. This is something very common in parts of Asia, especially you go to Malaysia or Indonesia. The tropical rainforest is now replaced, it has been cut and replaced with oil palm. Habitat loss. And the elephants continue to use the land where the oil palm is planted, because elephants show a certain fidelity to their home range. You know, just because you cut the forest, you're not going to send the elephant away. The elephant says, this is my land, so I'm going to roam around this land. And it comes into the oil palm plantation because it's a land where he has roamed earlier. But he also finds the oil palm attractive because palm is a food for the elephant. Yes, so habitat loss. Habitat loss in Central India, certainly. You are mining areas like this. And what does an elephant do? There's not a blade of grass for the elephants to eat. Therefore, habitat loss forces the elephants to go out and raid crops. Yes, certainly. But in other cases, you have loss of habitat, but not passages. Like, you know, Valparai, you have tea and coffee plantations. The habitat is lost, but the elephants are moving through these areas, through the tea plantations, from one forest patch to another forest patch. Or you have a dam like this, and the habitat is lost, the valley, river valley is lost, but the elephants can swim across, you know, and can move. So that's very, very obvious. Then you have climate and you have dispersal. Now, this is an aspect that's not very well understood, because climatic anomalies are very rare events. They're not very common events. Some of you may remember that in 1982-83, we had an El Nino event where southern India, you know, the rainfall was a deficit of something like 40 to 50%. And a whole elephant clan from Tamil Nadu, Hosur, now marched off into Chittoor district of Andhra, where Andhra had not seen elephants for 300 years. Right? That was a trigger. That climatic event, the big drought caused by the El Nino, was a trigger that elephants left Tamil Nadu and went off into Andhra and almost never came back. Some of those elephants went to Javadi Hills. Some of the elephants are in Tirupati. Many of them have been killed, but the elephants went. But climate was a trigger. There's a proximate cause. But then we need to look at ultimate causation. And ultimate causation, we need to look at foraging theory. What I found, you know, almost 40 years ago when I was doing my research in Satyamangalam in Hassanur, that an elephant typically needs to feed for 12 hours a day to meet its requirement. It eats about 8 to 10%, you know, body weight, fresh fodder every day. Needs to feed about 12 hours. But these crop raiding elephants, they would come at night. They feed for 6 hours. It is sufficient that they were able to get the quantity that they need for 24 hours. So instead of feeding, wasting your time feeding for 12 hours, you feed for only 6 hours in the crop fields. And you are able to get all that you need. So this is optimal foraging. You try to minimize the amount of time that you spend. So what is one of the principles of optimal foraging theory? Time minimization. You minimize the amount of time you spend in feeding. You maximize the amount of energy that you get per unit time, right? Then you also find that the crops are more palatable because they don't have, because you know the natural plants that they eat, the bark, they have tannins, they have alkaloids, you know, which are poisonous. But very often you find that the grass, the crop fields like the ragi and the paddy, they don't have any tannins, they don't have any alkaloids. So it's much safer for them, for the elephants to feed on these crops. And again, I go back to, you know, measurements that I had made of nutritive content of the plants. So these are protein, sodium, and calcium, and number of other nutrients that I measured. This goes back to my PhD thesis. And I found that between the wild grasses, that is the ragi and the paddy, you know, during the October, November, December, when the crop raiding takes place, the protein content is only 2 to 4%. But it is 5 to 10% in the cultivated, sorry, in the wild grasses, it's 2 to 4%. That is in your Themida, in your Imperata, your Simbopogon, and so on. But when it comes to the cultivated grasses, like the ragi and the paddy and the maize, it is 5 to 10%. Similarly, you take your sodium and your calcium, the levels in the cultivated grasses like paddy and ragi are much higher than that of the wild grasses like Themida and Simbopogon and Imperata. These are the grasses that I measure. Therefore, elephant is able to gain substantially by foraging in the cultivated fields. I told you they come and raid the stored food grain, they, you know, try to take the country-made liquor and so on and so forth. At the same time, I mean, I'm not getting into great amount of detail about this, but the male elephants are more prone to raid crops because a male elephant to come into must, you see this must, you know, the must gland is located between the eye and the ear of the elephant. And this happens about once a year. When the elephant comes into must, it has dominance over other males. It is able to get better access to the females for mating. Now, the male elephant has to be in good body condition, has to have good nutrition to come into must. Therefore, the male elephant is willing to take more risks in going and raiding the crops. Okay, this is a paper that we published in Animal Behavior. And you see this female elephant being associated with a male elephant in must in Kaziranga. They get much better chances at mating when they come into must. Therefore, that nutritious crop is very important for them. And I'll skip this because, you know, this study done in Africa many years later that corroborated what, you know, results that we obtained. These male elephants also come into larger groups. What I found was that when they are in the forest, they're typically solitary. When they start coming into the crop fields, they form groups of two elephants or three elephants or four elephants, because they form these coalitions and gangs to be able to tackle the farmers better. So here is a group of three male elephants in Hassan district. They are associating with each other. They are also learning from each other. So you have the, you know, the students and the professors also among the male elephant society. And my student Nishant published this paper more recently in Scientific Reports, where we looked at elephants in the Hosur landscape near Bangalore, the city of Bangalore. And you find these males are now coming into larger groups. You have young males, you have older males. The younger, the older males are the professors, obviously. And you may have assistant professors also, you know, in the media, you know, the mid-aged males. Then you have the young males, the 10-year-old and the 15-year-old males that are learning from these older males, from the professors and others, about how to rate crops, how to go and tackle the farmers when they try to chase the elephants away. It's a very, very fascinating kind of a response that the elephants are showing. And you see this bull group, you know, people may look at it in the night and say it's a family group. It's no family. There's not a single female here. They're all males. These males are coming into larger groups. You see the coconut plantation behind. Yeah, elephants are responding to human transformed landscape in novel ways. So these are adaptations that they're doing. And I'll skip this. Okay, you see all these kind of groups being formed. And the group size of the males increases with the availability of crops. So more crops are available, the larger the group size of these male groups. And so this is an adaptive strategy of these elephants to tackle farmers, to tackle humans who have transformed the landscape so that they can successfully now forage in the crop fields. So there is novel behavior being shown by these elephants. I told you there is culture. It is only not only the males that are learning from the older males, also there is learning within the family group. So here you find a young calf putting its trunk into the mouth of its mother and taking a little bit of plant and tasting it. It learns what is food and what is not food. So within a family setting, the mothers and the aunts are teaching their children, who are both daughters and sons, about what is food and what is not food. Also about crop raiding. And therefore, what might happen is that the sons and daughters from family groups that raid crops will continue to perpetuate this behavior when they form their own families. When they leave their families, they form their own families, they continue to perpetuate this learned behavior. Now, let me just show you some satellite tracking that we did of elephants to prove this point. Okay, this is an elephant called Raja. This is in the state of West Bengal. Our team has darted the elephant. We are putting the radio collar. The elephant is now got up after the radio collar has been fitted, and it is now moving within a certain landscape. The green is forest. The yellow patches here like this are the cultivated areas. This is a settlement. Okay, this elephant is right here near a village called Raja Bhatkava. This is called Raja Bhatkava, so we call it Raja. Now in the month of March, there is no crop. So the elephant is moving only inside the forest. In the month of April, people start cultivating maize. So he's visiting a couple of these villages to see what the stage of the maize is. The month of May, the maize starts maturing. It starts flowering. It starts setting grain. And he is going and raiding the crops in the villages where the grain is, where the crops are mature. Then he comes back in June. The crops are harvested. In July, in August, there is no crop. People now start cultivating paddy. So he comes back to the forest. In September, the paddy starts growing. He is now visiting Raja Bhatkava. In October, the paddy starts maturing. It starts flowering. It starts setting grain. Now he is moving actively between these forest area, the settlements. And he's raiding the crops, paddy crops. Now, 31st of October, he's here in the southern part of Baksa Tiger Reserve. 31st, he's here. right? And now he suddenly takes off and goes to Assam. Within a few days, within 4 or 5 days, the dates are coming up there, 6th November, 7th, 7th November, 8th November, 9th November, 10th, 11th, he comes back to Pakistan. So within a period of about 10 to 12 days, he makes a sudden dash of about 60 kilometers into Assam for raiding crops and comes back. And this we pick it up from GPS collar. Otherwise, we will not even know that he has gone to Assam and come back. He's obviously growing. He was killed later in a train accident. The collar had stopped working. He was by the side of a railway track feeding on a banana plant. A locomotive came, just the engine, early in the morning and knocked him down. Many elephants died that day. And you will also find that the train accidents to elephants are happening during the crop raiding season. You find a perfect correlation between the crops being cultivated and the number of train accidents twice a year. The month of May, the month of October, November. These are the two crop seasons, and these are the two seasons when the elephants get hit by trains simply because they are moving up and down the railway track, you know, across the railway track to go and raid crops. Similarly, this is another female elephant that we collared, and I'm not going to show you the entire movement, but this is in the close to the border with Nepal that you see here, and Bhutan is to the north. This elephant was most of the time spending its time in the small reserve forest called Apalchand. It would go to the Nepal border twice a year, in the month of May and the month of December, only for crop raiding. And the home range of this elephant group was 1,000 square kilometers. Now, let us come closer to home, to Tamil Nadu. I told you about the elephants going from Hosur to Chittoor and all these other places. Chittoor is over here. And many elephants went to Chittoor. One family of elephants came to Tirupattur, okay? And some few years ago, about 7 elephants were left there. Now, this forest area, if you have been to that Tirupattur Javadi Hills, you will see that it's a huge forested area. It's about 4,000 square kilometers. This forest area is equal to Mudumalai, Bandipur, Nagarhole, Wayanad, double the area of all of this. Where you have a population of 4,000 elephants, 5,000 elephants. There's only one elephant family, 7 elephants. All these resources are there. You can see the photograph I've taken there. Huge area of forest. This area can support hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of elephants. This elephant family should have been the happiest elephant family in the world. It has got a huge elephant kingdom, the Javadi Hills. No other family to compete with it. But it is not content to stay inside the forest. This elephant was roaming mainly along the forest periphery. You see houses like this, people, these are all wild elephants. You go to Vaniambadi, you go to, Tirupattur and all those areas, these are all settlements there. And the elephants are roaming there. Elephants are roaming on the main road, stopping the trucks and asking for food. Why? When it has enough food in the forest, it has more than enough forage in the forest. Why does it do it? Think about optimal foraging theory. It's not that these elephants are starving. It is not that these elephants don't have enough forage and therefore they don't have to come out, you know, into the human dominated areas like this, you know, risk being hit by trucks and all that. So think a little more deeply. Don't go with the popular narrative. Elephants have no food in the forest. Habitat is lost. Habitat is degraded. Yes, all that can play a role, but that's not the end of the story. Okay. Now, the latest paper that we published, 2019, Sanjita, my student, we looked at levels of physiological stress in elephants which are crop raiders and elephants which are found inside the national park. So this picture on the top, you know, if I don't show you the rest of the slide, this picture is taken inside a national park. This picture is taken outside the national park. Sorry. If I ask you which picture is taken inside a national park, which elephant is starving, you will say the elephant inside the national park has got enough food. It is in good body condition. You will point to the lower picture, Correct? I don't know if anybody wants to differ. But this is inside Bandipur National Park, Bandipur Tiger Reserve, which we are protecting, preserving, taking all the people out of the forest because we want all that forest and all the resources for the elephants. Look at how bony the elephant is. Look at the elephant below. Look at the wonderful body condition of the elephant. He is outside the national park. Okay. We also found that levels of glucocorticoids, which is a stress hormone, is higher in the elephant inside the national park, lower in the elephants below the national, in the outside the national park. Complete contrary to what people might think. So all the crops, all the extra nutrition that these fellows are getting is helping the elephants to not only build the body condition, but lower the levels of physiological stress. Okay, this is the reason the elephants are eating crops. Okay, now what am I doing with the picture of Ganesha? Lord Ganesha is a deity born out of conflict. It's the ultimate deity born out of conflict. Look at Ganesha, broken tusk. How can an elephant get a tusk broken? It is fighting. Ganesha must have had a fight, right? Or Lord Shiva, when cut off the head of an elephant, he cut off the head of an elephant that had got into a fight with another elephant. He's a troublemaker. Look at the pot belly of Ganesha. Lot of food sitting in there. Without crop raiding, how can you have so much of food sitting in the belly of Lord Ganesha? Right? Look at all what the Ganesha is holding. Radish, bowl of sweets, sweetmeats. How can all that come? Ganesha is a foodie, is an ultimate, was the foodie of the old, of the ancient times that we have raised to the level of a deity today. A deity born out of conflict. This wonderful icon, you know, that is Ganesha. That, no, some brilliant flash of inspiration, some man who invented Ganesha must have got around the 5th century. Ganesha is about 5th century AD, 1500 years old. Now people try to chase these elephants away. We try to put wildlife through barriers, population management, reverse fragmentation of habitat. Okay, all this, I will not get into too much of detail about all of this. Finally, we need to have landscape planning. See, you see the elephant is going across a trench. I refuse to believe that an elephant can do a circus feat like this. Just look at this picture. Till I saw the photograph, even myself with 40 years of observing elephants would never have agreed that an elephant can get out of a trench like or a pit as deep as this. See how he's getting out. They're capable of fantastic. Look how he's dealing with electric fence. The sole of the feet is a poor conductor. Is elephant Ranga. Look what wonderful body condition. Getting out of the forest to go into the crop fields for crop raiding. So now I come back to the question. Are Asian elephants browsers or grazers? Yes. We see them feeding on grass. The carbon isotope data shows that they are essentially browsers. But I'm trying to revisit the question. Okay. Now, a number of other people have done studies, Sivaganeshan, Bhaskaran. They all have done studies where they look at elephants in the, they have not done carbon isotopes, but they did direct observations. Elephants feed a lot on grass. When you observe them, elephants feed a lot on grass. Right? Now, why are they going so much for grass? Elephants' dental makeup, the number of lamellae, large number of lamellae, it's meant for a grazing diet. But why does the carbon isotope data still show that it is a browsing diet? Why? This is a question that we can ask. Okay. Now, I'm just showing this. I mean, this is about a horse, of course. This is something called hypsodonty. And over a period of time, animals, you know, the evolution of the mammals, you'll see that animals have adapted to a grazing diet over a period of time. Because Miocene, you had a reduction in the 7 million years ago, you had a reduction in the atmospheric levels of CO2. And C4 plants can photosynthesize even if you have very low concentration of CO2. Therefore, the grasses spread, grassland spread. Animals had to force many of the larger herbivores were forced to adopt a grazing diet. And, you know, this is related to climate change, natural climate change, where the earth has become cooler over time. If you look at the longer term geological record, now we talk about global warming today, but over the geological record of let's say 50 million years. The Earth has become cooler than warmer. Brief periods of warmth, but otherwise the Earth has become cooler. And with a cooler Earth, the grasses are spread, grasslands are spread. Cool conditions cannot support the kind of tropical forest that we see today. I come back to this same figure once again. Okay. The elephants 14 million years ago in South Asia, India, were mostly browsers up to 7 million years. Then you had atmosphere, you had cooling, you had atmospheric CO2 levels reducing, and then the grasses are spreading. Therefore, the elephants, proboscideans, okay, not modern elephants, proboscideans, ancestors, they start adopting a grazing diet. So all the necessary apparatus for grazing, the dental changes and all that they need, you know, that evolution takes place. It comes up to about 2 million, 1 million, it's all grazing. Suddenly, in the last recent time periods, 10,000 years or so, you know, they again have gone back to browsing. And the question is why? The question is why? And why do they raid crops? Okay. Now, I'll just show you the molar comparison. This is Loxodonta, more adapted to browsing. Elephas maximus is adapted to grazing. And the mammoth is the mammothus, which is extinct now. Extreme adaptation to grazing, it's dead. Okay, so if Asian elephants are adapted to a grazing diet, why do they eat a lot of browse? The trend towards a browsing diet began with the Elephas hycetricus during the Middle Pleistocene. Pleistocene is about, let's say Middle Pleistocene is about 1 million years before present. And maybe it's because of competition from another gigantic elephant called Paleoloxodon. This is something that has been discovered only very recently, Paleoloxodon. It was a grazer. So maybe the Elephas hycetricus, it faced competition. So it instead of grazing, it went to browsing, went into the forest. Okay. But Elephas maximus continued this feeding even though Paleoloxodon has disappeared. Why? We must remember that because of climate change, during the early Holocene, 10,000 years ago, we had the dawn of agriculture, the dawn of civilization. The earth was warmer than what it is today. The Indian monsoon was stronger than what it is today. And the forests were much more extensive than what they are today, about 10,000 years ago. So the Elephas maximus, 10,000 years ago, it was already a revolt. It would have to feed on browse only because a lot of browse is available. Then what happened? Agriculture arose. I don't know if I have another slide out here. Then agriculture arose. When did agriculture arise? 10,000 years ago. People started cultivating small areas. These small areas became larger and larger areas, especially in the north. The Indo-Gangetic basin was, you know, the spread of agriculture was about, let's say 5,000 to about 3,000 years ago. The Aryans came into the country from the northwest and spread further settlements across Indo-Gangetic basin. All the river valleys in the south, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, people started cultivating. Now, remember, the elephant has already been, now elephant is being pushed into the hills. The valleys are no more accessible to the elephant because humans have come and occupied it. Elephants are pushed into the hills. What is found in the hills? Forests are found in the hills. What is the dental adaptation of the elephant? No, grazing diet. So the crops in the valleys are now still very, very tempting to the elephant. The elephant is forced to be a browser because of climate change, because of the spread of forest during the early part of the Holocene. Then agriculture spreads, further pushing them into the forest, even though the climate has become drier, but people have started cultivating and the cultivation has now become very, very tempting because now humans are now replacing the wild grasses with the natural grasses in the valleys, in the river valleys. And therefore, the elephant is now kind of decided that, yes, I am adapted to a grazing diet. Why should I eat only browse? Let me go and raid the crops and let me feed on grass, because that's what my dental apparatus is used to. And the elephant now raids crops with a vengeance. Okay, so this is something that just the last couple of years is something that I have proposed. So the root cause of crop raiding, you know, it's a complex kind of a biological climate change, human land use change over a period of time, and the elephant's evolutionary response to all of this in terms of its natural behavior, its social behavior, its feeding behavior, right? All this is happening. And what I say is that today there are many elephants that are found entirely in agricultural areas. The young ones have grown, they only know banana and paddy and ragi. Not like us old timers, you know, going into a Udupi restaurant or some restaurant having an idli and dosa. They want the pizzas, they have seen the burgers, they have seen all the other fast foods that I'm sure the younger generation, most of you listening to me, I'm sure you go and have all of this. I also have once in a while, because when my daughters insist that we want to have a pizza or a burger or a beer or a, you know, or a pasta, you know, we have to agree, of course, my wife and I have to agree to it. We can't say no, otherwise we'll be starving. We have to do it. Today, these younger generation of elephants don't know what is the natural forage anymore, not natural food anymore. It is now in the fast food mode, the world of the fast food. Therefore, it's going to be much more complex for us to solve the problem of elephant-human conflict, because not only the behavior, the diet of the elephant is also changing over time. And we humans, climate change, all this has come together, and the elephant has become an ultimate foodie. Thank you. Thank you very much. I'll just take a minute to, I think I think just an hour or so. I'm sure that every one of you has seen this, right?
Yes.
I was not seen it. Being in Pondicherry, it would be a shame. This is the most magnificent sculpted figure of an elephant ever made by anybody in this world. I challenge any of you to show me a sculpted elephant that is better than this in terms of its quality. This is a life-sized elephant at Mamallapuram, just a short distance from Puducherry, Pondicherry. It is so natural. Look at perfectly proportioned bull elephant at the front with the tusks. You know, look at something that I think all art historians have missed between the eye and the ear. Look at this little bulge here. Can you see it? Can you see this little bulge here? That is the musk gland of the elephant. The musk gland is swollen, which means his bull elephant is in musk. Right? He needs all that crops. He needs, you know, that's how he's built up his body condition to be successfully expressing the musk. Very natural. This is a female elephant. Folded ears. She's more than 50 years of age. It's the most magnificent sculpture of an elephant. It's more real than a real elephant. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I'll be happy to answer any questions.
And, thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, if you could just give me 2 minutes, can I take a 2-minute break and come back?
Sir, sure. By that time, we can also like compile the questions.
Yeah, please. Yeah. Just 2 or 3 minutes. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I'll just come back to my.
Okay. By the time sir comes back, I will also post the link here through which you can give your feedbacks, and you will receive the certificate from that. And please continue to keep posting your questions so that once sir comes back, I will you can start reading out. I'll call out your name, and then if you're still here, you can read out the question on your own, or I will read it out to him. Thank you. Also, if any one of you would like to catch the recorded session of this webinar, it will be posted later this day on the YouTube channel. I will just post the link of the YouTube channel here. So if you want to refer to the webinar once again later, you can go and check out the recorded session. Welcome back, sir.
Okay, I'm back, and let me see the questions that have been posted. Let me see.
Yes, sir. Do you want me to read them out, sir?
1 minute. Let me just locate. The problem is that every platform has a different location for the chat. So I'll read it.
Okay.
I only hope this does not become the new norm, because I'm not a person who likes just sitting in front of a computer all the time. I like to be out in the field. Which I can't. I'm doing it. In the last month, I've been able to go to Nilgiris and see elephants. Be able to see. Conserve nature wanderer. Pop-up is disturbing. Okay, all that is over. Right. Ajit Sahu. Right. My question is, a common misconception is that there's not enough food in the forest. Food that. Is there research on this? Okay. Now, I would say that there is enough food in the forest, you know, natural food in the forest for elephants. There may be certain forests in which lantana has taken over. You know lantana, the invasive plant lantana. And therefore, that may have reduced the food availability for elephants. That is true in very areas with very dense elephant population. So if you take Mudumalai, Bandipur, Nagarwale, these are very dense elephant populations. The elephant population is very, very high. And there might be a food shortage. I'm not denying there is, because of takeover of land by lantana, for instance. Okay. And then easy availability of food. Yes. So as I told you, food is available in plenty. The food is more palatable, the crops, and more nutritious. And therefore, the attraction towards the crops will definitely be there. As I told you from the Jawadi Hills example, I can give you examples from many other examples also. So elephants will continue to eat crops. So it's a combination of all these different factors. Then there is Rahul. Is invasive species like lantana? Yeah, that's right. Absolutely. Yeah. It could be. But lantana has spread in a very big way only in the last 15 years. But elephants have been raiding crops before that. Okay. But lantana could have worsened the situation with regard to forage availability. I know in Mudumalai that the total amount of grass in the understory is reduced because of lantana substantially. And we have done research on that. Have there been any places where human elephant managed successfully? Right. That's the $1 million question. You may even be able to earn a prize of $1 million if you can manage it successfully. But, the only way is to keep an elephant inside the forest completely. Put a barrier. I have seen the Addo National Park in South Africa where they have a barrier where they use steel cables from an old tram line with wooden poles. They have a mechanical barrier. But in India, those things become very expensive. So it's a suite of different things. You need to put barriers. You need to chase them. You need to capture some elephants that are in conflict with people regularly. You need to put electric fences. But today, there is a hanging wire fence where it's much more difficult for an elephant to get through. Just the last year, people have been using this, show some promise. Chemical deterrents like chili powder on a small scale. So you need to use a suite of different solutions. That's a separate topic by itself. Restricting elephants using fence help and reduce. Yes, Rahul, yes. If yes, will it disturb their range movements? Yes, yeah. What you should do is you should not put the electric fence in a fragmented habitat. So if elephant's natural movement is to go from one forest patch to another forest patch, like in West Bengal, North Bengal, they go through tea gardens. You should not put a electric fence just around the forest patches. It will restrict them. It will not allow them to describe their annual home range. But if you go to, let's say, Bandipur, the eastern northern boundary, elephants from there don't have to go anywhere. The eastern boundary of Nagarhole, elephants don't have to go there from anywhere, from there to any other place. Or the eastern boundary of Hosur Forest Division. Okay, so you have to look at it at the landscape scale, and the outer boundary of the landscape is what you should put the fence on. Does tusk help males to attract females? Yes. I mean, that's what I think has happened in the course of evolution. We have published several papers on this. If you write to me or email me, then I can send you the papers. The tusk story is a talk by itself. Okay, I can give a 1 hour lecture on the tusk story itself. But musk is more important today than presence of tusks. I'll send you those papers too. Do females also have tusks? They have tushes. They have small, very, very small, a few inches sometimes, called tushes. They don't have full-blown tusks. Asian females don't have. But African elephant, the females also have tusks. And that's a completely different story. Okay. Why the African females have tusks, Asian females don't have tusks, and so on is a different story. Why do some male elephants not have tusks? Makna. There has been selection against tusks. Maybe selective capture of the tusked male for use in the army of kings over thousands of years. So the gene for tusks is reduced in the population. Especially you see that in Northeast India, where about 50% of the males have tusks and 50% of males don't have tusks. Then of course the poaching for ivory. So you come to South India, early 1980s, about 95% of the males had tusks. Today, only about 80% of the males have tusks. Because, you know, you had the poaching gangs that killed a lot of the males with tusks. Is elephant-human conflict due to faculty forest management practices? Faulty forest management practices? Well, see, let me put it this way. There is a certain management of the forest. If I get into forest management, then, you know, I'll have to talk about lantana, I'll have to talk about fire management. We're suppressing fire today. Fire helps promote the growth of grasses. Fire also may help suppress lantana. It's a whole completely new topic. A lot of research has to be done on this. But we can possibly certainly manage our forest much better. A lot of invasive plants are coming in. Senna spectabilis, the most recent thing, is just coming and choking our forest. That will finish off all the forage for wild herbivores. Ajit Sahu, sir, when farmers ask what are the direct benefits from elephants, is there some answer to satisfy farmers? No. What is the direct benefit of the farmer to an elephant? In Sumatra, they use the elephants to plow the fields. Yeah, sorry. I'm not getting into detailed answers right now. Huh? They call makna. Genetic mutation. Okay, that's a makna. Ritvik Nandi, shouldn't there be animal bridges in India? Yes. There should be, especially bridges below highways, you know, or below railway lines. And I think these are being incorporated into all new projects where you have major roads so that animals can pass below the, you know, through subways. Yes, that's being incorporated today. Benefit of elephant is huge, is a protector of forests, keystone species. Yeah, they're keystone in seed dispersal, you know, turning over, a big turnover of the biomass, dung nutrient turnover, all that is happening, yes, certainly, within the forest, yes. And somebody has posted a comment, I'll just leave you out to read it. I wouldn't try to answer that directly. Mayank Shukla, there's a study from Africa, under poaching pressure, elephants are evolving to lose tusks. Yeah, absolutely. So what has happened in Asian elephants has happened before African elephants. Absolutely. Sudeep Tha, during the study, was there any unusual feeding behavior that you observed? See, unusual means, let me put it this way. Supposing there is a novel food, which is potential food. Let's say there's an acacia tree. Acacia species introduced into the natural habitat. Elephant has not seen that acacia, but acacia is food because acacia is leguminous, like elephants can eat on acacia. It takes some time. First 10 years, 15 years, elephants may not feed on it, but later they start feeding on it. Eucalyptus is from Australia. In many parts of India, elephants don't eat eucalyptus. But in Satyamangalam, I found that elephants were eating the bark of eucalyptus. So they have learned after some time that certain groups learned that eucalyptus bark is palatable, maybe does not do them any harm. So there is a whole process of learning, you know, that actually happens over a period of time. Giri Murugan, there were some rare and new sightings of bull elephants in African savanna. Yes. Yeah, I mean, elephants will go to any great lengths to obtain food. They can do all these circus feats. You saw that elephant clambering out of the trench, you know, that I showed you. So this is very common. I have seen this both in India, and this is quite common. Elephants rearing up on their hind legs and, you know, breaking a branch or getting some fruit. It's very common. Beehives. Asian bees are not aggressive like African bees. All these are gimmicks. They will not work in the long term. In a small way, in a village or two, in a very, very small way, you can scare elephants a few times by using beehives, but nothing in terms of long term. It will not work. Bhagwati, thank you. Nice presentation, thank you. Raksha, it's a point of the life cycle affect the grazing, browsing performance. Raksha Honavara, I hope you can come and do research on this with me.
Yes, sir.
After the last 35 years.
Yes, sir.
35 years, no, more than 35, 38 years. I'll share one small insight with you. Elephants that I found having mostly grass in the diet have lower body condition, poorer body condition. Elephants that feed a lot on the browse rich habitats have much better body condition. How does this translate into reproductive success? It's a question I've been asking, but none of my students have yet undertaken research on this. So if you're interested, you can come and take research. Don't do research on this. Thank you. Does conflict increase with increase in distance from? Yes, it does. Basically, yes. Increased tolerance of communities. Well, complex question, Ajit, you know. And you have a lot of questions. Natasha, Jennifer. Hometown is Ooty. We live in Mudumalai. Yes, I also live in Mudumalai. I'll be there from the coming week. I'll be there in Mudumalai in Bokapuram. So we can say hello to each other. My house is 800 meters from the Bokapuram temple. And it is between Jungle Hut and Jungle Retreat. It's the last property just before Jungle Retreat. Just come there and ask for me and I'll be there. Come across elephants. Ronald, yes. There are some newer elephants coming into our area. Yeah, I'll be there most probably from Wednesday till end of the month. I'll be in Mudumalai in Bokapuram. Excellent. Thank you. Any other questions?
There's a new question, sir. There's one question now.
Right. Increase accessibility learning. Could be, Mayank, yeah? Elephants are observing, the younger fellows are observing the older male elephants. You know, in all male groups, younger males are getting their cues from the older males. But typically, let me tell you, the older males are not teaching the younger males to be aggressive. They are teaching them to be calm. Okay. But among family groups, what might happen is you might get the mother, the matriarch, the aunts, you know, they attack people. They, you know, indulge in all these mock charges. So the younger elephants, you know, both young males and females will be learning this kind of behavior. So I think that aggressive behavior is a culturally transmitted trait. I'll give you a small example. African, I've been to this place. This is a place called Addo in South Africa. 100 years ago, there were only about 20 elephants left in this Addo. Because hunters came and hunted like crazy in Addo. They shot almost every elephant with tusks. So today you'll find all elephants are without tusks in Addo, African elephants without tusks. In 1975, Ian Douglas Hamilton has described this population as the most aggressive African elephant population ever known. Most aggressive. The elephants would get the smell of a human, they would come charging out. In fact, they stopped hunting because the elephants then started hunting the hunters. And they killed them. So everybody was afraid to go into the jungle, Addo National Park. near Port Elizabeth in South Africa. I went there in 2003 and I went there in 2005 or 6. Okay. A fence has been put around this. Hunting has completely stopped. There's a totally barricaded fence. This elephant population is, I would say, the most gentle elephant population I have ever seen. The most gentle. 1975, Ian Douglas Hamilton says the most aggressive elephant population known in Africa. I observed in 2003 that is the most gentle elephant population I have ever seen. You sit there in an open vehicle, huge elephant just going, just brushing past you, nothing. They never bothered about me. I got photographs taken in 2003. I didn't have digital camera, I only had a film camera, but I've taken many pictures. So there is a transmission of behavior. It is a learned behavior, cultural transmission. So all that aggression of the great grandmothers and great great grandmothers is gone. Now the mothers are calm, their children are calm, elephants are calm. Okay, so that's the example, right? Differences in African nation, Sumatra. No, I would suggest that you just look at any book, you will get the differences. Huh? But Sumatran and Asian is the same. Huh? They're not different species. Okay. Thank you.
Sir, thank you so much, sir, for taking your time and for this great talk and for all the information that you've given us. Venturing into the world of elephants through your views has really been enlightening. And questioning the general assumptions about, you know, what causes, like, you know, elephants to crop raid and everything has been my biggest takeaway. You've certainly given us a lot to think and ponder and read upon. We are truly grateful for you being here. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Raksha. And thanks to all of you. I see 50 people who have joined, who have been listening to me. Yeah, and please send some students. Let me also tell you, a lot of young people, Partha, now, the Ministry of Environment has launched the long-term ecological observatories program. And I am the chairman of the program, and there'll be a lot of opportunities for young people to work. You know, in a variety of subjects, you know, on forest ecology, grasslands, on herpetofauna, on birds, and so on. So if young people want to come and work, please just contact me. I'll put you on to the right. I'm the chairman of the national program. So I'll put you on to people who will, you know, hopefully some of you will get opportunities to work on this.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Partha, bye then. Yeah, take care.
Thank you to all the participants and thank you Partha sir and Ramuti sir and any other faculty if you have joined. Thank you so much. And to the participants, once again, I'd like to remind you, please use the form link that I've sent, and then also you can check out the recorded session today evening. Thank you so much. And if you have any more questions, you can maybe mail it to us and we can pass it on to Sukumar sir. Thank you.